everyone, I'm Amberly, and today we're going to be installing and configuring the IDE that we're going to be using throughout this video series, Visual Studio. If you'd like to know more about what IDEs are, check out the other video, Introduction to IDEs. If you plan on following along throughout this video, you're going to need your computer and an internet connection. Go ahead and pause now and resume when you have all that set up. Let's go ahead and get started. Okay, first we need to download our file. So of course we're gonna turn to Google, right? We can go here and we are gonna search for Visual Studio 2019 download. All right, and we're gonna grab this first option. Now, if you're on a Mac, I know you're looking at this going, they have Visual Studio for Mac. Yes, they do, but it doesn't compile C++. So if you're on a Mac, I recommend that you get Xcode from your App Store. That'll work perfectly. All right, for everyone on PC, when you get here, we're gonna grab the Community Edition. So let's go ahead and click Download. And that should start happening down in the bottom left corner. Yep, perfect. Once our download is finished, we're gonna start the install and we can just go ahead and click on this. Now, I want to mention that what we're installing is actually the Visual Studio installer. You can think of the installer as kind of the manager of your Visual Studio program. And what I mean by that, and you'll see it here in a minute, is that in Visual Studio, we are going to install the C++ language into Visual Studio. Now, as your skills develop, you might want to come back someday and do other languages. Let's say you want to try out Unity or Python or something like that, and you want to add those to Visual Studio, you'll do it through the installer. So the installer is just kind of like the manager of the program. All right, once your installer finishes, we'll see this window here, and this is where we can choose the workloads or the languages that we want to use. So we're going to do C++. So I'm just going to click that right here, and it'll automatically select all this stuff we need. Now, I mentioned, for example, if you wanted to come back and add Python, you just run the installer, modify Visual Studio, and then you can just select these to continue to add as you desire. So we're going to go ahead, and when we're ready, we've got everything selected, we're going to click Install. Okay, once your install's finished, Visual Studio should open up automatically, but if not, just go ahead and search for it here or click on this icon and fire it up. So on the left, we're seeing some projects that have been previously opened. You're not gonna have this at this point right now, but when you come back later on, if you wanna open up a project, you can just grab it from here. We're gonna go ahead and create a new one though. So I'm gonna click Create New Project. Now here, I'm seeing a list of options that I can choose from. It might be tempting, you know, to pick one of these, but resist the temptation. We just want a clean from scratch project that we're gonna do ourselves. So just make sure here it says empty project for C++ and click next. Now we're being asked what we wanna name our project. I typically like to follow some sort of naming convention, which is just, you know, like a standardized way of naming things that often starts with who this project is for, so work, school, personal. This is a tutorial video project. And then I'm gonna put the title of it, so whatever the name of this program is here. So other ways that this has looked is sometimes like homework, week 5, you know, or something like that. Work, this component, I find that it's helpful to stay organized because you can really get a lot of these going and it can get crazy when you just have projects 1 through 75. Our next field here is asking us where we want to save this project. If you want to save it somewhere specific, like let's say you're at school and you want to save it on your flash drive, you just click those three little dots and then choose your new location. I find typically though that the default is totally fine. Solution name, same thing, we're good as is. When we're ready, we're just gonna click Create. Okay, now that we have our new project created, we find ourselves in what is known as the workspace. So this bar up here, this window is called properties. All of this is known as the workspace, and it's important to learn that term. You're going to find that in the tech industry, terminology is actually really important, so we might as well start getting our professionalism on right now, right? So the first thing that we need to locate in our workspace is a window called the Solution Explorer window. You might already have it. It's usually here on the left. You can see the titles of the windows right here, like this is the Properties window. If you do not see Solution Explorer, no worries, it's very easy to add. Or if you just want to like double check that you have it there, you can go to View, Solution Explorer, and it'll open it up for us. The Solution Explorer shows us all the files that we're using in our program, and those are listed out here. Now, if your Solution Explorer window is somewhere else in the workspace, that is totally fine. Something cool about Visual Studio is it actually allows us to customize the layout. So I can grab my Solution Explorer window, and you kind of see this overlay right here. If I hover with my mouse over one of those directions, I can kind of snap this window somewhere. I like to have it on the left, but you can put it wherever you like. Okay, like I said, the Solution Explorer manages all the files that we need, so we currently need to add a file so that we can do some coding. This is called a source file, and this folder here is going to manage it. To add one, we're just going to right-click, add, and we are gonna get a new item. Now, if you had worked on a program like at school or something, and you save the source file to say a flash drive or you know your Microsoft OneDrive cloud account, whatever, you could click existing item and then go through your folders to wherever you saved it at and add it in. This is a really great way for transferring work between like school and home. So we want a new item though. So I'm gonna go ahead and click new item. Okay. And we want just this default one right here, .cpp, which actually is C++, easy to remember. And we're cool with source, and it'll save it in the default location. Perfect. And we're going to go ahead and add that. Awesome. So this is where we'll actually be doing some coding, is in our source file. And as you can see, that is now appearing over here in our source file folder. The next window that we want to check for in our workspace is known as the error list window. Now, you might have it down here. Sometimes there's already windows down here, kind of like in a tab format. Go ahead and take a look there. If you don't see it, or if you just want to, you know, it's not going to open it twice, so you can follow along here. Just like Solution Explorer, we're going to go to View, and then here's our error list window. Okay, great. So now that's added down here. And just like Solution Explorer, I could pick this up and I could like snap it into place wherever if I wanted to. I kind of like it being down here at the bottom though, so I'll just leave it there. The reason that we want this window here is because it's going to show us any errors that we might get that would prevent us from compiling or running our program. And that actually leads me to the next item on the tour, our local Windows debugger right here. When you're ready to run your code, this is the go button that you'll press. So this will start the compiler, it'll run everything. To show you what that looks like, I'm going to pop some code in here real quick. All right. Oh man, but we've got an error down here in our error list. Okay, it's telling us here it expected a semicolon on line 14. Okay, but where is line 14, right? We don't want to count like all the way down these, right guys? So let's go ahead and turn on line numbers. Line numbers are incredibly helpful for dealing with errors because we know exactly where we need to go. So to turn those on, we're going to go up here to Tools, and we're going to go down to the very last option, which is Options. And then this is going to put us in general. Let's click this little triangle right here to collapse that. Okay. And then we're going to scroll down and try and find out right here text editor. And then click this to expand it a little bit. And then within the text editor menu, we want to find C++. When we click on that, our settings over here is line numbers. And let's also go ahead and enable word wrap while we're here. That's very helpful. So before we continue, you want to make sure that you have word wrap, showing visual glyphs, and line numbers all enabled. Okay, once you're set, let's go ahead and click OK. Excellent. So now we can see here on the left that we've got line numbers. Perfect. And then over here, this little kind of curved hooked arrow is showing us that our text is being wrapped around. So previously, this was all just on one line and we would scroll left and right to see it. This wraps our text so that it keeps it all within our console window here, which is just excellent. Okay, so our error is telling us it is on line 14. So if we take a look here, all right, line 14, there we go. And it says we're missing a semicolon. Now, this is a pro tip for troubleshooting. When you get an error like this, take a look at the line, but then look at the line before it. So technically, yes, the error is on line 14. However, I'm going to actually resolve it on line 13. So whenever you have an error, look at the line before it. That's probably where the incident's occurring. All right, perfect. All right, now that we have an empty error list, we can run this. So let's go ahead and do our local Windows debugger. All right, now we have this black window pop up because we've run our program. We started the compiler. This black window here is called the console. You can think of the console as the interface for your program because this is where all input and output happens. So it's very important. We talked about the terminology workspace. The terminology console is also important. So when we say we're printing to the console or collecting from the console, it is specifically referring to this black window that we're seeing here that only appears when we're running our program. Okay, so I'm seeing some text here. Thanks for running your program. How is my day going so far on a scale of 1 to 10? Well, since I'm hanging out with you lovely folks, I'm going to give us a 10, and I'm going to press enter to submit that. When I do that, I'm going to get this nice little message. That's great. Keep on rocking. Okay, excellent. So we run our first little program here. Let's go ahead and close the console out, and I'm going to do that just by clicking on the close window in the top right. Pretty common for most programs. And now we come back to our workspace. So it looks like by running my program, I got this new window here called the output window. Totally cool. I'm happy with that. It can live there, but I'm going to go ahead and merge it with my error list window because I don't want it taking up all this space. So I'll just go down here and drag and do the drop. So it looks like when I ran my program, it opened up this output window, which is 100% natural. So if you have this, I'm going to go ahead and leave it open, but I want to combine it with my error list window just to kind of save myself some space. So I'm going to use my drag and drop and just combine it right there. Excellent. So now I have output, but also my error list, and this will kind of show up as tabs. And so, guys, you can really build out here a customized workspace with all the tools that you need, which is awesome. All right, so say that we're happy with our program. We just ran it. We checked everything in the console. Looks good. We're ready to be done for the day. So to save your program, you can do that one of two ways. You can go to File, and you can do Save All. I always like to do this. Or there's a shortcut for that right here, and you can just button mash that like crazy just to be safe, right? And when you're confident you've saved, to close Visual Studio, we're just going to go right up here and click on this Close X. Now, the next time that you open Visual Studio, you're going to see here a list of your recent programs. So this is the one that we were just working on. To open a program, you can go ahead and click on it just from the recent list, or if you want to go and open up a new project or a solution, say, you know, off your flash drive from school or work, you can click that and then just navigate to wherever you're saving that program. And when you open up a Visual Studio solution, you need to make sure to grab this .sln file, and then we'll just double click. And that opens up for us. And as you can see, our workspace is exactly as we left it. Now that you've learned about the purpose of IDEs, how you're going to use them as a developer, and even set one up, I recommend moving on to our next video, Hello World, so you can put that IDE right to work. Thanks for watching this video, everyone. I hope you found it helpful. And remember, your ideas are awesome and unique, and they're worth building. Go make it happen.